Уважаемые коллеги, я благодарю всех вас за вовлеченность и особое внимание к области рынка труда. На пути в будущее, по курсу устойчивого развития, для сохранения максимально комфортной среды обитания, человечеству потребуется не только набор новых навыков, но и изменения в образе мышления.
As the global economy develops, the planet's natural resources are at their peak utilization. That is why modern science and innovation aim at addressing environmental problems. In the session Minimum Emissions, Maximum Results, we will discuss successful business models and innovative tools of green economy in different parts of the world.
Our first speaker in this session is a man who transformed the desert into a green oasis. And this is no metaphor. I'm delighted to hand over to an expert whose methodology of a love-driven economy has helped solve global 21st century problems in his home country. His approach allows SecM to remain a leader in the organic farming market in Egypt. Helmi Aboulish, CEO of SecM, is with us today.
Dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to be with you here at the Global Impact Conference 2020. I'm hoping that I can share with you some valuable information about our experience and our example of SecM in Egypt, in the desert. Now, how did this all start in Egypt? My father, late Ibrahim Aboulish, who is a born Egyptian, went to Austria in the 50s, studied, lived, worked there, married my mother, and was a very successful producer and researcher in the field of pharmaceutical products. In the 70s, 1975 in particular, he took us on a trip to Egypt, his home country. Us is the family, my mother, my sister, and myself. We went with him, and he, on this trip, had the inspiration that he would like to go back from Austria to Egypt to contribute to a more sustainable, holistic development initiative in Egypt. He had the idea to create a community in the desert near to Cairo, where people would work, live, and learn together. And he did believe that all these challenges Egypt was facing in the 70s, some of them were the result of an unbelievable population growth. So he left Egypt in the 50s, and Egypt were 18 million people. He came back in 75, and there were 45 million people. Today we are 100 million. Some pollution because of the spray of chemical fertilizers and the spray of chemical pesticides. A lot of problems in our education system, governance system. A lot of problems in regard to water scarcity and housing, poverty, jobs, unemployment. He did believe that with his initiative, SecM, he can contribute and show that there is a model for sustainable development, which will work in Egypt. So when we went back in 1977 to Egypt as a family and started SecM in the desert, he decided that he wanted to do this by using organic and biodynamic farming in the desert, which was never done, never heard of, and nobody did believe it will ever work. But he also decided that he wants to do it in a new, different economic value system. He wanted to do it with Iqtisad al-Mahabba, economy of love, which, as he did believe, will contribute to more prosperity in Egypt and all those involved than a profit-oriented, profit-maximization-oriented, conventional capitalistic business model. And he did also believe that we had always and have always to have in mind that it's all about human development, individual human potential unfolding. Whether it is economic, societal or cultural activity, in the end what really counts are the people. And this is why he decided that he will always give an opportunity to all the people in the SACEM community to unfold their own potential. And last not least, he also did believe that we have to care for the community around us. In a time when there was no term called corporate social responsibility, he already decided that we will invest 10% of our profits into community development. So if you take all this as a business model, you can imagine that everyone was very, very sure that this will not last. This will not work, this will never be successful, that this is a mission impossible. But against all odds, and this is why I'm standing here in front of you, a miracle unfolded over the last 43 years. And today, in SACEM, there is a beautiful oasis which has evolved out of the desert, where 2,000 people work, live and learn together. Hundreds of kids go to school, 2,700 students go to our university for sustainable development. Hundreds of farmers around us grow organic and biodynamic products. Millions of customers all over Egypt receive organic and biodynamic products from SACEM. Obviously, the question is, how was this possible? And there are a lot of studies in the air, and there are a lot of people coming to make case studies on SACEM. But let me try to give you a quick and simple way to answer this. First, organic farming, biodynamic farming in the desert works. With compost, the black gold for our farmers, we could transfer dead sand into living soils. Living soils which produce all kinds of crops in Egypt, which can have better yields than conventional crops, use less water, sequester carbon in our soils, and handle the salinity issues. So compost and organic farming contributed to this miracle of SACEM. Would organic farming alone produce this miracle? And I have to disappoint you, the answer is no, because it needed economy of love as a concept to receive these products from organic farms, our own and other organic farms in Egypt, to handle it in the supply chain, to process it in our factory, to distribute it to all the retail partners we have in Egypt and abroad, to finally reach a consumer, and to make sure that everyone in the supply chain, from the farmer to the consumer, gets a fair share of the added value, that everyone gets a fair price for his work. And this is what we did over the last 43 years. And also, it is not a concept which is yet mainstream. It worked and showed to be very, very efficient, very, very productive, and very, very competitive. What do we produce? We produce foodstuff, organic food. We produce phytopharmaceuticals, and we produce organic garments and textiles. And if you believe it or not, in the field of organic food, for example, we produce 800 million tea bags of herbal teas for the local Egyptian market. And with this 800 million tea bags, we are the market leader with 77% of the market. And our competitors are multinationals like Unilever and Nestle and many others, which can show you how competitive economy of love can be if it's done in the right way. But still the question, is organic farming and economy of love capable of producing such a miracle like SACEM? And my answer again is no. If we wouldn't have also invested into our community, into creating a living learning organization and community in SECAM, where young and old and men and women, Christians and Muslims, all people from all walks of life can come together, work together, and achieve this miracle, which in any organization can be achieved when the outputs of one and one can equal 10. And this is one of the other reasons that this miracle of SECAM was possible, that we continuously invested into our community, into our organization, to make it a learning, living organization. But still, the question, would this living, learning organization with the economy of love and organic farming have yielded the miracle? And my answer is still no. Wouldn't we also have, from the very first day, focused on individual human potential unfolding? Wouldn't we have, from the very first day, really have also invested our time, the time of the SECAM community, to help every one of us to find his inner call, his inner talents, and unfold his potential? SECAM would not have achieved this miracle. And just to give you an example of how far this was a focus of what we did, I can tell you that my father, when we started off in the desert, did two investments, the first two investments of SECAM. In the desert, when there was no house, no well, no water, no electricity, no nothing. The first investment was a tractor, the second investment was a piano. And this is symbolizing our belief that arts, that culture is as important as economic activity. So, to sum up, I would like to say it is this focus on all four dimensions of sustainable development, the ecological part, the economic part, the societal part, and the cultural part, which together could produce such a miracle. And obviously, what is the center of all this sustainable development efforts of SECAM was in the past, is today, and will stay in the future, is our focus on individual human development. All this together can produce miracles, miracles in SECAM, and we believe miracles all over the globe.
Helmi, thanks for your speech. I would now like to ask you a couple of questions. What recommendations can you give to other organizations in order to make their work more sustainable?
Now, obviously, again, I'm very much inspired by my experience in work in SECAM. And I can tell you from the miracle I have seen evolving in front of my eyes that I strongly believe that every organization in the world could use the same principles to make their work more sustainable. What are these principles? One, have a strong vision of the world in 20, 30 or 40 years. What do you picture this world will look like? What can you imagine the future will bring to us? Not what the past wants to project into the future. Second, work on your mission to this vision, always along the four dimensions of sustainable development. Cover the ecological part and really define for yourself the key performance indicators you want to reach on the ecological part, on climate change, on energy, on the depletion of resources, on water, biodiversity, and many, many more. But also cover the cultural sphere. Put yourself key performance indicators for what unfolding potential you would like to reach for your members of your organization, your stakeholders, your clients, your suppliers. And also tackle the issue of creativity and innovation. Invest into research, into holistic research. inspired not only by natural science, but also by humanities, maybe spiritual science. And don't forget that the biggest source of inspiration and creativity is arts. So engage with clear key performance indicators in the field of arts and artistic in co-creation in your company. And last not least, also tackle the issue of health, of integrative health. How do you measure the health of your organization? The impact of the health your products and services are providing for the bigger community. And then move on to societal targets, societal impacts of sustainability. How is your organization impacting your community? How is it impacting the society in large? How is it impacting the whole globe? How are the relationships organized in your organization? How do you contribute to a healthy development of the rights sphere in your organization, your community, your society? And last not least, of course, you have to set for yourself clear economic key performance indicators. You have to put some financial indicators, but beside also put some indicators tackling the issue of no waste, of circular economy, of the economy of love, of fair prices, of transparency, and true cost accounting. Just to mention some of them. And don't forget also to think about the sources of funding, the money, the ownership, the banking relationships you have. So, if you can tackle all these four dimensions, put clear key performance indicators, and in the end, never forget to mainly, and in the center of everything you do, to focus on human development, your company will be more sustainable. And I wish you good luck on this trip.
Thanks. One other question. What effect did 2020 have on your company's strategic plans? What adjustments did you have to make? And what initiatives in the field of sustainable development and climate change have you focused on this year?
An extraordinary year for everyone on the globe, whether it was a company, a farmer, a school, a university, a hospital, a politician, everybody in our society was tackled. Now, interesting enough, in the SECAM community, where we are working on the issues of integrative health since many, many years, we were able to prove to the world around us that an intentional community like SECAM has built up some resilience to tackle such a pandemic in a very meaningful way. And yes, we did a lot to protect our community members. And we did wear masks, and we did control temperatures, and we did make a lot of disinfection, and so on. But at the same time, we also did care very much for our social relationships, because we believe that the health of a human being is depending on his body, his soul, and his mind. So we did continue to meet, we did continue to exchange, we tried to carry everyone in our community with love and happiness. And at the same time, and not to forget, the cultural events which we were used to in SECAM did in a new modified way continue. We did continue to nourish the soul and minds of our people. And the result is just great. We have tackled, obviously, as part of the bigger community, have had some impacts of Corona in Egypt, but in SECAM we are very happy that we could overcome this pandemic, first wave at least, very well. Now, from the other side, it also helped us to refocus. We did, over this year, rethink our vision for the world in 2057, our vision for Egypt in 2057, in the next 40 years to come. And actually, we did find out that we believe that this wake-up call of the pandemic will help us to reach our vision even earlier than we have originally intended in 2017. We have put more efforts to mainstream organic farming in Egypt. We are now applying more efforts to transfer SECAM and our communities to renewable energy than we did before. And we did more efforts to tackle the issues of sustainable products in every regard of our lives in SECAM during this year. So, to summarize, I would say it was a wake-up year, a wake-up call. We are happy that we could show our resilience. We did a lot to protect our community members, and in our hearts we did pray for all those who were ill and suffered. But at the same time, we also have put together a plan how to engage for a more sustainable world, for the world we envision for the coming to us from the future in a more efficient way during this year. Thank you very much.
Thank you for sharing your unique experience with us. The personal motto of our next speaker is, the more you give to people, the more you receive from them. He has always been passionate about creating new businesses and engaging with people with diverse backgrounds. It is this interaction that inspires him the most. Please welcome Chief Strategy and Sustainability Officer of Schneider Electric, Olivier Blom.
Thanks a lot for inviting me for this Global Impact Conference. My name is Olivier Blom and I'm leading strategy and sustainability at Schneider. So the purpose of my presentation will be to tell you how we deal with sustainability at Schneider Electric, and more important, what we do for ourselves, but also for our customer, to have a stronger impact on our environment and the planet in general. So what is the case for change? First of all, and I'm sure it's very well known by all of you, but there is a sense of urgency on what we need to do in terms of climate change. The Paris Agreement of 2015 has created really a framework for government, for organizations to do more. And I think everyone realized that it's now that we have to act and we cannot wait furthermore. Point number two, there is a very strong demand from our shareholders who wants to understand what we do in terms of ESG strategy, environment, social and governance. And more companies are evaluated also through this filter of ESG on top of what are only your financial results. Of course, we should talk also about the social inspiration everywhere in the world. People are asking for a world which is more equitable, where there is a higher respect for the different races. It can take different form in different parts of the world, but we see that really there is a strong demand coming from society, for companies, for organizations to deliver a better world, and again with a better impact for everyone. And last but not the least, the entire ecosystem of a company, whether you talk about supplier or customer, are also asking companies to become more sustainable and to help them also as an organization to be more sustainable. So all of that has been really framed around the Sustainable Development Goals that you know very, very well. Point number two, at Schneider Electric, sustainability is very strong in our DNA, and that's probably the part which is interesting to share with all of you. We put sustainability very, very high in our agenda, starting by the culture of the company. When we speak, for instance, about our employee value proposition, we always say to our employees or future employees, there are three reasons why you should join Schneider Electric. One, because we have a meaningful purpose. And again, this is what we want to do to become more sustainable as a company. We want to be an inclusive company, and we want really to have a high level of empowerment to have a strong impact locally. We have put sustainability, as I said, very high in our agenda. Since 15 years, we have commitment that we declare usually every 3 to 5 years with metrics that we measure on a quarterly basis and that we disclose internally and externally. And in a couple of minutes, I will tell you what are the commitments we are taking actually for the next cycle. We have incorporated also CSR, call it sustainability, call it ESG, as one of the key criteria for the incentives of our leader since many, many years. And we have also asked the board of Schneider to create a dedicated focus also on sustainability a couple of years ago. And last but not the least, we've decided more than a year ago to publish our own carbon pledge, again in line with the Paris Agreement. So you can see that it's not only about taking a few commitments here and there, it's an entire ecosystem that we have built in our company to put sustainability on top of the agenda for the company. So I was talking about carbon pledge. That's quite fundamental. And I would say it's important because it's somewhere the foundation of our sustainability strategy. Not only because it's very important for the climate change that we have all to contribute for, not only because it's a very high focus of the Sustainable Development Goals, but because also that's the business of Schneider Electric. The mission of Schneider Electric is to contribute to this climate dilemma that we have all to face. So it was very normal that as a company that should deliver decarbonized solution for our customer, we are role model in the way we are leading our commitment. So I will not describe everything, but just to keep it short, we've decided to become net zero in scope 1 and 2, which is our own scope, by 2025. It's very important. As you can see, it's not necessarily the biggest challenge that we have in terms of carbon emission reduction, but the focus is more and more on what we call the scope 3, which is what we want to do upstream to help our supplier, but what we'll do also downstream to help our customer to be more carbon efficient. And of course, by doing that, we are fully compliant with a science-based target that governs somewhere all those carbon pledges. So I was telling you just a few minutes ago that we are about to publish our commitment for the next cycle. And we spent a lot of time actually, so this conference is coming at the right time, to reflect in the past months on what we have done over the past 15 years, over the past 3 years, from a sustainability standpoint, and what we want to do to take sustainability to the next level at Schneider. So I'm very pleased because you are probably one of the first one to see this presentation to tell you what we have decided for the next cycle. First of all, from a strategic standpoint, everything starts from the purpose of the company. Our purpose at Schneider is to empower all to make the most of our energy and resources, bridging progress and sustainability for all. That's very important because that's quite fundamental at Schneider Electric. This is from everything that starts at Schneider Electric starts from that purpose and mission. So how do we differentiate our sustainability strategy? We differentiate by playing on both sides of the equation. What do I mean by playing on both sides of the equation? One, we want to be leading by example in our own ecosystem. So this is what we do at Schneider Electric to be a role model from a sustainability standpoint. But it's also what we do as a business to contribute to our customer by being part of the solution. So every time we look at our sustainability strategy, it's about playing on the two sides of the equation. So now, what are the commitments we've taken for the next cycle? First of all, from a long-term standpoint, we've taken 6 key commitments. We want to act and have an impact on climate, on resources, on trust and ethics in general, on equal opportunities for all, a very strong focus on the generation, on the topic of generation. And we all realize that there are multiple generations working at the same time, and it's very important that you give an equal chance to all generations. And last but not the least, we want to make sure that we have a stronger impact on our local ecosystem. And if I have to explain to you a little bit on how we work at Schneider Electric on that, for each of these transformations, we are taking commitment. We are taking commitments which are measured through specific metrics, and I'm not going to describe all of them in detail, but we have in that specific case defined 11 commitments for the next cycle, and those 11 commitments are global, which means that they apply to all the entity of Schneider Electric in the world, and we are going to measure in the next 5 years our progress versus our 5 years ambition, and we will publish internally and externally the results of those metrics. So that has been really the way we have translated our long-term strategy into concrete objective for the next cycle. And maybe just to tell you a little bit more, I'm not going to describe the six, but I'm just going to give you two examples. First one, act for a climate positive world. So what does it mean? For this long-term transformation, basically what we want to do is to help to decarbonize the world, to decarbonize the planet, and it applies to what we do as a company, what we can do for our customer, but what we can do also for our supplier. So for each of those long-term commitments, we have always this kind of framework. On the left-hand side, we have a certain number of objectives that we give to ourselves. These are the famous metrics KPI that I just mentioned before. And in that specific context, we want Schneider Electric as a company to have 80% of our revenues, which will be qualified as green revenues by 2025, which means that it has a positive impact. Our activity has a positive impact on the environment. The second objective we fix to ourselves is to deliver 800 megaton less of CO2 emission for our customer, both what we call avoided and saved, which means, to make it simple, how we can impact our customer on brownfield and greenfield. And we are going to measure that since 2018 until 2025. And the last commitment we have taken here, as I was talking about scope 3 downstream, which is more customer, and scope 3 upstream, which is more about our supplier, we are building a program with our 1,000 top suppliers. They are not necessarily the top 1,000 biggest supplier of Schneider Electric, but they are the one who have the biggest impact from a CO2 standpoint, so we have a big impact in terms of footprint. And we are leveraging here our own solution at Schneider Electric, what we call Energy Sustainability Services, so our ESS experts are working with our supply team to create a program where we are going to help our 1,000 top suppliers to divide by two their CO2 emission. And to do that, there are multiple ways to do it, by leveraging more renewable electricity, by having access to PPA, by implementing some solution to measure and to reduce your energy consumption. But to cut short, we are building a program to help those suppliers by leveraging our own expert at Schneider Electric from what we call ESS. And beside that, we have a couple of programs that I'm not going to describe. I spoke already about the carbon pledge, but we are including also carbon price, for instance, for all the strategic decisions of Schneider Electric when it comes to supply chain or for our R&D decision as well. To take a second example of long-term commitment, the topic of equal opportunities for all is extremely important at Schneider Electric. That's really a strong element of our DNA, of our strategy. At the end of the day, we want to make sure that all our employees everywhere in the world have the same chance of success at Schneider Electric, whatever their nationality, their gender, their education, their race. We are creating an organization that gives the same chance of success to all. And that has been always an objective in our strategy at Schneider Electric for many years. Now, in this next cycle, what are the commitments more specifically that we are taking? First, what we call the 50-40-30 is a very strong commitment on gender equality. 50% means that we want to be to reach gender parity in recruitment, 50% male, 50% of female for all recruitment that we are doing at Schneider Electric. 40 means 40% of female in frontline management, and 30% means what we want to achieve at the senior level, which is basically the top 1,000 leaders of Schneider Electric. We are very proud to say at Schneider Electric that we have already 38% of female in our executive committee, reporting to our CEO Jean-Pascal Tricoire. But you still see that at the next level, we have still a lot of work to do to progress, but that's a strong commitment we are taking. And also, we are always taking commitments that go outside Schneider Electric. And in that case, we had a program which aim at giving access to electricity to 50 million people by 25, which has been a program that we have been running for many years. And we have a certain number of other programs. For instance, we continue to have a very strong focus on pay gap, making sure there is a gap which is lower than 1% between the salary of our female and male employee. We commit to have a minimum salary, what we call a living wage, for all our employees everywhere at Schneider Electric. We have also a program, for instance, that we call Open Talent Market, to connect people and opportunities at Schneider Electric to develop our people. But we have also committed on a certain number of policies which create a very high level of inclusion, whether it's a global family leave policy or another one which is actually pretty much on top of the agenda in 2020, which is a flexibility at work policy, which helps the people to have a good balance between the time they could work at the office or from home. So that was just to give you two concrete examples from our long-term commitment, how we translate that in short-term objective, supported by a certain number of programs. And last but not the least, I told you before that we have a very strong business at Schneider Electric related to sustainability with our energy and sustainability services organization. I talked about PPA, I talked about renewable, but we have also an organization that helps our customer really to track their energy consumption, to track their CO2 consumption, and to be able to measure, but also going up to their own ESG reporting. And all the commitments that I've mentioned to you before are tracked in our software that we call EcoStruxure Resource Advisor, that we use for ourselves in that case. But of course, that's a practice which is very well known that we sell also for our customers. So, to summarize, that's what I wanted to share with you today, how sustainability really starts from the top of the strategy of the company, which is part, again, of the purpose of Schneider Electric, how we try to play on the two sides of the equation by leading, again, by being a role model in the way we drive our own operation at Schneider Electric, but also by trying to have an impact outside Schneider Electric, both on the supplier side and customer, because we believe at the end of the day, the world will become more sustainable if companies take what I would call 360 degrees commitment that have an impact in our entire ecosystem. So I hope this presentation was useful for all of you. Of course, it's we have a limitation, it's only digital, but we will be always more than happy to answer any kind of questions. So feel free to contact us if you want to know more. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for your inspiring story. The rational use of resources becomes the norm when it is simple, convenient, and practical. High technology allows us to create products and solutions for a green present and future in a most efficient and innovative way. I'm thrilled to announce an expert who knows firsthand about this particular area, the CEO of Cathode Materials, Emin Askarov.
Today is how we make an impact to fight climate change. I strongly believe in personal example. While such examples are never perfect, but they demonstrate how people can make an impact. So I will tell you my story. I have been working in the energy sector for almost 20 years now. And at one point, I've asked myself, why am I doing this? Why I work at very mundane and boring sector? But frankly, at that time, there were plenty new industries taking off, most of them in the IT, but also in finance and new mobility. You know, all those glitzy and shiny new industries. So I knew I've had about 20 plus years to make a meaningful impact to people around me and to the world in general. What would I do? I've decided to pick a challenge. No, the challenge that is important globally, and to tackle in which I can meaningfully contribute. This shouldn't have been any teeny-weeny challenge. It should have been huge and enormous, a challenge to the whole world. And I had to have, or to develop, the skills necessary to make a meaningful and lasting impact. You know, there are a few big existential challenges to humankind, like nuclear non-proliferation, artificial intelligence, hunger, and of course, pandemics. All are important. But you just have so many hours in your life that you can make efficient use of. And these hours have to make an impact. So for me, It was actually fairly easy to identify such a challenge because I could see it around me every day. We are all familiar with it, and it's climate change. So I've made my life's mission to combat climate change, both at professional level and at my personal level. And I've started taking action. On the professional level, I've started with working in a company that runs combined heat and power plants. They make electricity and heat, and they use coal and gas to do that. At that company, we minimized coal use, switched more to gas, and reduced wasteful generation, allowing more efficient and clean hydro energy to take our place. Funny enough, such a move, while might seem counterintuitive, actually reduced our losses and led to a healthier business overall. And today, that company is developing smart city applications. My next step was more focused. In 2015, I've spearheaded a project to build 1 gigawatt of wind farms. These wind farms could power almost 800,000 homes with clean energy. But when we started, Russia had almost no experience with wind power and no manufacturing capacity. But today, this company operates the biggest wind farm in Russia and runs wind turbine assembly facility. And this facility sources parts from multitude of small and medium-sized businesses in Russia that did not exist a couple of years ago. Today, I run a company that makes lithium-ion batteries for public transport and energy sector. Lithium-ion batteries gave energy mobility to the world, and they will help significantly reduce emissions from fossil fuel vehicles. A challenge that I face here is how to make these batteries sustainable, meaning to make and manage them in a way that they don't end up in a toxic waste dump. When we will figure that out, it will be the last piece of the puzzle that will make electric transport fully environmentally friendly. And believe me, this will have an impact. What is a common threat to all these experiences that I had? All these businesses I've described were a part of Rosatom. They still are a part of Rosatom. This company made it possible to initiate and execute all these sustainable projects because Rosatom places values of sustainability and green energy at its core. But do you have to work in a big company to make an impact? Not necessarily. In my private life, I also put the challenge of climate change at the forefront. Whatever you do, you can act to live in harmony with our environment. For example, I'm a strong believer in credo, what gets measured gets done. So I've started tracking my carbon footprint. So when I first measured it, to my horror, I realized that my carbon footprint is almost 30,000 tons of CO2 equivalent per year, while a sustainable level is around 10,000 tons. That means sustainable, meaning it will get absorbed by the environment safely. But at least now, I have a goal to work towards. I research what I can do to minimize my own carbon footprint, and then I act on it. For example, I've sold my second car. Now I use more public transport and car sharing services. I shop locally produced and seasonal foods, trying to squeeze more life out of my household appliances and from my gadgets, rather than buy a new one each time a new edition comes out. What is more rewarding now is that I try to buy quality clothes that will last longer. Now I have a good excuse to buy more expensive jackets. Even more important, I find it to share with my findings and practices with my friends and community by writing about my experience on social networks. So, what does that all mean for you and people who don't work in Rosatom or any other big company? First, you, and only you, can decide whether and where to make an impact. Once you decide, you need to take action. And don't be afraid if you think you don't have the skills. If you are motivated by a big challenge, you will pick up necessary skills. Find a team. Find a company that shares your values, your goals, and commit yourself fully. And even if your life and work is centered around different big challenge, you can still make an impact to combat climate change and live in harmony with the environment. It will not require a big effort, but a few, and quite often, pleasant changes to a lifestyle. We can all make an impact. We have to try. Thank you.
Я благодарю всех участников сессии. Оставь свой зеленый след.